fabulous things, butterflies. These exotic ones are very colourful and very attractive. Not always easy to photograph, even though we're in a butterfly house, but you know, there are nearly a million species of insect worldwide and thousands upon thousands in this country, and some of them can be really tricky to get into your lens.
Although there are so many species and often so many individuals, when they are active, they are very active. That really sums up the problem with photographing insects. They either move too much or they're too small. But although really good macro photography is not always easy because of the behaviour of some of your subjects, the basic equipment is not technically difficult to master. A macro lens is simply one that has been optically corrected to focus very close to things. If you want to get closer still, then you can simply add extension tubes between the camera and the lens to produce images which are life-size or even greater. Photographs capture instants in an insect's life, but many people don't realise that insects have a beauty which can also be brought out in artistic pictures. The main problem, as always, is knowing how, where and when to approach the animals, and for some, overcoming the instinctive fear that so many people seem to have of creepy crawlies. For example, some typical bad press victims, the mad, bad, biting and stinging brigade, if you like, are the social insects, like ants, bees and, of course, wasps. It has to be said that not many people will be this comfortable close to wasp or this close to a wasp nest, but photogenically they are absolutely tops. They're beautiful animals. They are currently my favourites and are very important to the ecology of environments like woodland. I'm not the only one prepared to devote a lot of time to them. Someone who combines a professional interest in the well-being of woodland insects with his photographic hobby is Forestry Commission keeper John Gulliver.
Well, I use the camera mainly as my wildlife notebook, and when you're privileged to see some scenes in nature, such as this slide of a hornet mating sequence, they're in the typical S-shaped position, and the queen is at the back of the male, and when she thinks enough is enough, she'll chew the male's abdomen, and that will cause the male to release, and then they'll fly off.
Now, you've put this nest in this box, haven't you? You've rescued it, in fact.
That's right. This nest was destined to be destroyed, so I collected it, relocated it here, and it gives me the opportunity to be able to photograph the hornets and be able to show people that the hornet isn't the aggressive wasp or the villain that people often believe the insect to be. They are our gentle giant of the wasp world. The thing that you must bear in mind is not to breathe on the insects, because that tends to excite them. So when you're doing close-up photography, just hold your breath and then take the shots that you want. And also make sure that you don't vibrate the immediate environs of the nest chamber. And with those two elements in mind, you can do photography of social insects with no fear of being stung.
So, there you go. Just hold your breath. Sounds too easy, but it really works, and it will allow you to poke your nose right into a hornet's nest to see and photograph some of their secrets. These workers are busy tending a new group of cells, whilst this queen wraps herself around eggs to incubate them. John's photographic notebook keeps a record. In fact, he has compiled a comprehensive record of insect life on his beat. Now, despite the rampant enthusiasm of John and I'm sure you won't all be dashing off to the nearest hornet's nest. So let's turn to some subjects that are more passive, immobile, and generally prettier. Plants, or more specifically, their flowers. Most of the British beauties are quite small, so more macro work is necessary, and also some research into finding the right place to go.
When a lot of people see grass, they get out their mower and they mow it. But to do that here would be absolute sacrilege. In fact, to let a sheep loose here would be a tragedy, because this is one of Britain's most important habitats. It's a tiny postage stamp of ancient downland,
And this species here, juniper, is a good guide to that. It's looking very wizened and indicates that this particular place is very well preserved. In fact, it's only preserved because it's a series of old chalk pits, and that's prevented ploughing. And no ploughing means a great diversity of flowers, including everyone's favourites, the orchids. And just down here, there's a fabulous little glade of pyramidal orchids. Now, this species isn't particularly rare, but it is very attractive. It ranges from pink through to a rich purple, and it's actually pollinated by night flying moths. So during the daytime, it's not particularly aromatic, but in the early evening, it produces a pungent perfume to attract those moths in. But there are orchids that are not quite so colourful. I happen to see one just on my way up the hill. This less than glamorous fellow is called a frog orchid, and you can see why. It's got that characteristic olivey green, froggy colour. In fact, it's almost invisible on the ground. And that brings us to a good point. If you're on a reserve such as this, do stick to the paths and use your eyesight. This particular species likes to grow on very heavily grazed areas, and it would be very easily trampled. But this whole reserve is alive with different species of orchids and lots of other grassland plants. June and July are the months when most of the downland flowers look their best, both the common and the rare. Bright oxeye daisies vie with the dowdy musk orchids. But as with insects, flowers do demonstrate a surprising problem. Plants have no visible means of locomotion, yet they're continually moving because of the wind. It's the plant photographer's greatest enemy, but I've come up with a solution. I call it my wind tent. My mates call it a mad lampshade, but just look at this. The principle is quite simple. It's a small tent to keep the wind off the flower. Now, on three of its sides, each of here and the top, it's got diffuser. That's quite useful in strong sunlight because contrast on flowers is not very attractive. And through here, you get a nice, soft, even light. The back is a clear sheet of cellophane, which you can shoot straight through, and the front is open, so obviously it's important that you shoot upwind all the time for maximum plant protection. But there is another problem here, frequently encountered, and one which causes a lot of concern, and that is gardening. There's a lot of other plant growth here, and as you can see, there are some fronds of grass running right through my chosen flower. You have to be quite judicious, but using a small pair of scissors, you can snip out some of these pieces of grass. Don't take too much out. A microhabitat around a plant is very, very important to it. Not many of you will want to get up at the crack of dawn every morning, but plants do look good covered in dew, and of course there's an easy solution, the plant mister that you might use for your house plants. You have to be quite careful not to get it on the cellophane back. Put a little bit of mist on here, like that. You've got a beautiful dew-dropped flower. When you're shooting things, though, from a low angle, a tripod can be a real pain. So what I use is a bean bag. Produce from some canvas and split peas for the cost of just a few pounds. Once you've got it well and truly bedded in, it will be almost rock solid, and you can use very long exposures. OK, I've got to admit, tramping across a nature reserve one of these does make you look like a bit of a prat, but I've got to tell you, it saved me on more than a few occasions.
I've used my wind tent to photograph orchids all over the country. Apart from the fairly common pyramidal orchids, I travelled all the way to Anglesey to find a much more local species, the June helleborine. These rely on sandy soils. I found these marsh orchids in the New Forest. And this whole group of dactylorhiza orchids is actually quite difficult to identify because they're so variable. The clown-like face of the bee orchid actually mimics an insect. And what about this, the extremely rare lizard orchid? Stunning. These snakehead fritillaries show how you can manipulate your light tent snaps. This is frontal lighting against the sky. But by putting a black cloth behind the tent and adjusting the angle to the sun, I created these backlit lanterns. And finally, just add dew with the houseplant mister for a soft champagne effect. Even common plants like the humble dandelion benefit from the wind tent. By allowing much slower shutter speeds and smaller apertures, you can achieve a greater depth of field if and when you want it.
In thousands upon thousands of insects, bees, wasps, beetles, bugs, and everyone's favourite, butterflies. Thistles are good, honeysuckle's good, but bramble is brilliant for insects. All sorts here. One problem with brambles, though, are their long, snaggy tendrils. You only have to touch one of them, and the whole bush will vibrate, and everything that's pitched there will take off. So you have to ballet dancer your way into it. Stretch your foot right forward, put it down as gently as possible, and then pivot on that leg as close as you possibly can into your subject. It has to be a very slow movement, and your arms can get a bit achy. Using a tripod in amongst all of this vegetation is almost impossible. You're bound to knock something and scare the subject away. So try using a monopod. If you extend these like this, they're much easier to probe down into the vegetation without causing too much disturbance. Once you've got it there, you can rest on the camera and once again pivot forward, keeping your eye there and a gentle bit of focusing underneath. And that has got me right on top of a male silver wash fritillary. And what an absolutely fabulous insect that is. This is pristine. It must have emerged a matter of perhaps just days ago. You can greatly improve your chances of success by choosing your macro lens very carefully. If you've got a 50mm macro, it will only give you life size 1:1 over a distance of about this. If you spend more money, you can get a 200mm macro lens, and that will give you the same life size image in your photograph at a distance of about this. There's much less of a chance that you're going to scare your subject away when you're stalking it. Now, photographing butterflies means moving very, very slowly. Keep your eye up to the eyepiece and try and use a winder. Saves all of that finger movement. It will require some time to get very close to them. Now, one thing that butterflies do all of the time is move in a most irritating way. They're continually balancing on the flowers, flicking their wings. If you can, wait for them to settle completely and wait for their wings to be completely flat. That way you won't have so much trouble with depth of field. And depth of field can be a real problem, and you may find therefore that you'll need to use quite high ASA film. I'm using 200 here today, but really, as soon as the sun goes in, it's not enough. I need 400 ASA film to keep the body of the insect, its antennae, and the tips of its wings sharp if there's any degree of V in its body. If you do have good depth of field, of course, the other problem you have is irritating little details in the background. Perhaps an out-of-focus bramble flower that's completely white, which will dominate the frame. It will be an ugly scar in the corner of your picture. So as well as looking at the butterflies, make sure you do concentrate on what is going on behind them. It's something that takes a little bit of practice, really. Just leaning in really gently, really slowly, imperceptibly focusing the lens. And now I'm right on top of a white admiral. A splendid woodland insect, which is actually quite difficult to get close to. If you're going to go out photographing butterflies, don't say to the wife or boyfriend, "I'll be back in an hour," because you won't be. You'll be back in about 3 days if you want a successful shot.
Butterflies do require lots of patience, especially if you want to get the lighting right. They look really good backlit, like this, an orange-tipped male. Or the stained glass panelling of the wings of a marbled white. Even the wing of a dead tortoiseshell butterfly caught in a spider's web makes a striking abstract. Backlit on spangled aranathrum grass, this male brimstone has become a tiny sulphur lantern. Of course, being small, insects can be caught and carefully manipulated. This peacock butterfly was arranged on a poster in my garden. And this oak cricket was carefully placed on an oak leaf, sellotaped to my front room window to catch the full sunlight. The beautiful marbling of a woodcock's wing provided a setting for this burying beetle. A little tabletop landscape. Finally, I was struck by the glossy bonnet of a black hearse, and placed a stag beetle onto it to achieve this surreal reflection. And here's a moral note.
Because insects are more easily manipulated than many other sorts of animal, they're very frequently taken into captivity to photograph. But of course there are a few golden rules. Firstly, always use the right equipment to catch them with. This is a butterfly net, and the netting is very soft, so it doesn't harm the insects in the process of capture. Secondly, when you're moving them from A to B, make sure you use the proper receptacle. If you do use a jam jar, make sure it's very well ventilated, because otherwise they can become quite sweaty, and of course, never leave it in sunshine. Lastly, and most important of all, no matter where you caught that insect, make sure you take it back there. Once you've got it, you're entirely responsible for it, so you do owe it to look after it.
Now, all the photographs we've seen so far show insects sat on things. We all know how impossible it is to follow a butterfly once it takes off. But what about this? A male orange tip in mid-stroke. This photograph was taken using high-speed flash. The photographer was Stephen Dalton, who has become world famous for his pictures. He has pioneered this type of photography to overcome the peculiar problems of catching insects in flight.
Probably the most severe problem, in many ways, was the sheer unpredictability of insects. You cannot persuade insects to fly in a straight line. Birds can be. Nests and eggs act as an irresistible attraction. Insects don't. They're sort of zigzag all over the place. Then there was the problem of the shutter, because a normal focal plane shutter takes about a tenth of a second to open. And in a tenth of a second, an insect can fly up to a metre, depending on which insect it is. And then, of course, there are the obvious problems with macro photography, just photographing small things and depth of field. Funny enough, one of my first pictures was of dragonflies. It was of the common sinpetrum, which I caught some distance from my home, and I took it back home with me. And stuck it in the flight tunnel. It flew straight out, fired the camera, and straight out through the window. I left the window open. But that one shot, it was just perfect. It was just in the right position. Wings were in a nice position. It was sharp. Everything was just right. Very, very unusual, because normally, you know, you can spend days and days and get through many films before getting any satisfactory result.
Mm. A lot of people will be very surprised looking at these pictures. I'm sure they just won't imagine that insects' wings get into these positions. Some of them almost look unnatural. Were you surprised yourself when you saw the results?
Oh, it was very, very exciting, because nobody had really seen what the wings were doing. In fact, all my early photography was done in black and white, because I couldn't wait for the colour results to come through. So I just kept them all to myself for months.
Most of the insects photographed were taken in Stephen's studio. Here, he's assembled a complex array of powerful flash guns. Infrared beams are arranged ready to fire the shutter as soon as the beam is broken. Stephen is setting this to take a picture of a bird, but the principle is the same whether the beam is broken by an insect or something larger. But first, the studio has to be blacked out, not for the camera, but to define the flight path of the bird. The feathered friend in question is Stephen's pet parrot, Pertie. It can take many attempts to get a good picture. Using painted backgrounds and carefully constructed sets, the results can look very convincing, revealing beautiful details of the bird's flight. One of Stephen's most famous pictures was taken when he noticed swallows swooping into his garden pond.
Sometimes they drank, sometimes they dived in to have a bath,
right,
and out again. It's quite difficult to see what they were doing, actually. That's one of the reasons why I photographed it. I wanted to see what was going on. The camera was about where we're standing. Good old Hasselblad again.
Right.
motorized drive, and usual beams, there's a beam, a light beam from here, and a photocell on that side.
Yeah.
About 2 inches off the water. And the bird used to come in, break the beam, fire the camera.
You make it sound very easy. How did you get the result in the end? Lots of work.
Lots of work. It took about 3 weeks, actually. It really did. But, in fact, the final photo, the best photographs were taken while I was in Brighton for the day.
Came back.
Did some shopping and came back, and 12 exposures taken. And that was all right. I wish I could organise all my photography like that.
High-speed flash photography is beyond the scope of most of us, but the world of the very small is not the only secret of nature we can reveal with our cameras. Stephen still uses flash photography, but a very much simpler system, one that needs nothing more complicated than bog-standard high street photo store flash guns.
Well, I've tried in other places.
He is after badgers.
You know, 5 or 6 miles away from home, and then I just discovered this set about a couple of years ago.
Well, this is obviously the setup, Stephen. Run me through it, if you don't mind.
Well, I started off by sitting in the hide and firing the camera release manually. And after a few sessions of that, I tended to fall asleep, especially after a couple of glasses of wine for supper.
Well, they do come out rather late, don't they? I'll give you that.
And so what I've tried to do is to tempt them away from the sets, and I've baited them to this log.
Stephen, this is obviously the setup. Run me through the hardware.
Well, you can see the camera on the tripod. It's a Hasselblad, motor-driven Hasselblad. Flashes, well, you can see the actual flash heads. There's two here.
Yeah.
And there's two by the Badger.
I'm not being rude, but these flashes don't look very high-tech.
No, they're very old ones. I think I've had them since I was a student in London. So they're, 25 years old or something? But they work well. They're very efficient.
How are you triggering the flashes on the camera?
I'm using a thin tripwire with a little switch. Well, the tripwire is underneath the log here. And Badger comes along, hits the wire, and fires the camera.
Will it fire again straight away?
It should do, yes.
Yep. So if a whole clan of badgers turn up, you get multiple exposures and great success in night one.
12 fabulous pictures of badgers, yes.
Not a whole clan, but one pin-sharp, properly exposed view into the hidden world of the badger.
Next Thursday, Chris Packham reveals how to take watery wild shots without getting your feet wet. At the same time, 8:30. A Channel 4 book called Chris Packham's Wild Shots, a new look at photographing the wildlife of Britain, is available from most bookshops, price £16.99.